Amen. Son of Asaph, O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth, who has set thy glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings hast thou ordained strength because of thy enemies, that thou mightest steal the enemy and the avenger. When I consider the heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visit him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and hast crowned him with glory and honor. Thou makest him to have dominion over the works of thy hands. Thou hast put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, yea, and the beasts of the field, the fowl of the air and the fish of the sea, and whatsoever passeth through the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. My God, God is a good God.
Yeah,
Glory.
Man.
He is a good God. Yeah. Bless him. Amen. Well, tonight, I want to talk to you tonight about there is no common sense in faith. Glory. We're gonna talk about how that faith doesn't make sense at times. Glory. Amen. We're gonna be talking about that. That there is no common sense in faith. Ah, help Lord. So we're going to go over a couple of scriptures and we're going to talk about this. Amen. And so tonight I'm going to be talking to you also about another level of faith. All right. Glory. See, we go from faith to faith, from glory to glory. Amen. We go from one place to another place in God, from one level to another level. Amen. And so, my God. And so God wants us to grow in him.
Yes.
And he also wants our level of faith to be increased. Hey, glory. He don't want us to always, my God, maintain one level of faith.
Yes.
But our faith has to be increased. Amen. Hey, glory. Help, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
My God. And let me tell you something. In order for your faith to be increased, you don't need more faith. Think about it. You only need to use what you got.
Come on.
Glory. You gotta use what you got.
Yeah.
For the Bible declares, I believe it's Romans chapter 12, the Bible declares that he has given us the measure of faith.
Yeah.
Hey, so God has already given us the measure of faith.
Amen.
And for you to do what God has called you to do, he has already given you the measure of faith.
Thank
Glory.
You.
You need to know and understand that he has already put it on the inside of you. Glory. You need to know that in your belly, yeah, is all the faith you need to do what God has called you to do. I believe in 2 Peter, verse 1, verse 3, it tells us that God has given us all things that pertaineth to life and godliness. According to that scripture, you already have all things.
Yeah.
See, you got to know and understand that when Christ came on the inside of you, all things came on the inside of you.
Yeah.
Glory. All things that pertain to life and godliness.
Yeah.
See, when you understand that, that when God came on the inside of you, that all of God came on the inside of you. Hey, glory. You see, that's how magnificent God is.
Come on.
I have all of God on the inside of me.
Amen.
God did not say, I'm going to give you 10%. I'm going to give you 5%.
Jesus.
I'm going to give Peter 40%. Mm-hmm. I'll give Moses 50%. Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
God, when he comes on the inside of you, he gives himself all of you.
Yeah.
He don't hold back none of him. Hey, glory. But the problem is that we give him 5%, 2%, 1%, 3%.
Yeah.
Huh? Mm-hmm. But he give us all of him.
Yes.
So when you know what's in you, yeah, the hope of glory. I got Christ Jesus in me, the hope of glory.
Yeah.
My God, when you understand that I got, so now that we have all things that pertain unto life and godliness, glory. See, when you understand that you already have it,
you already got it.
You don't gotta try to seek to obtain, but you need to know how to release the God that's on the inside of you.
Yeah.
You gotta release what's on the inside of you.
Yes.
Glory, you gotta release.
Yes.
Amen. So I'm gonna be talking tonight, glory, about another level of faith.
Yes.
Another level of faith. Help, Lord. Help, Lord. You see, I refuse to doubt my God. I refuse to doubt God. I refuse to doubt my God.
Yeah.
Glory. Amen. I believe it's Mark chapter 11. Around that 23rd verse, he says, doubt not in your heart.
Yeah.
Doubt not in your heart.
Mm-hmm.
Glory. A heart with no doubt.
Come on.
I'm talking about a heart with no doubt.
Come on.
Hey, glory. I'm talking about somebody that believes God with all of their heart.
Yeah.
Ain't got no hesitations, no reservations, my God. But their heart is just given unto God, and they believe God with all their heart and have no doubt.
Yeah.
My.
Thank you, Jesus.
A people with no doubt.
Yeah.
Yeah. You see, with God, you can put all of your eggs in one basket.
Yeah.
Come on. With God, you don't need a plan A, B, and C.
Jesus.
But all you need is a plan A. Glory.
Amen.
Glory. Yes. Come on. I said you can put all your eggs in one basket.
Yeah. That's right.
But see, yeah, people tell you don't put all your eggs in one basket.
Yeah.
Yeah. But with God, yeah, come on, somebody.
Come on.
I can put all my eggs in one basket.
Yeah.
Glory.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'm talking to you tonight about a different level of faith. Glory. My. Help, Lord. Let's just look at, let me tell you something. In order to really exercise your faith and not to doubt in your heart, you need to have an understanding of how God feels towards you.
That's right.
You see, if you think God is mad at you, and then it will be hard for you to trust him. If you think that God is against you, then it's hard for you to trust him. Amen. But we know what Jeremiah 29:11 says.
Yeah.
Jeremiah 29:11 says, for I know, glory.
Yeah.
God said, for I know.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I know the thought that I think towards you.
Yeah.
Glory. No matter what you think that God thinks towards you,
yeah,
God said, I know.
Yeah.
The thoughts that I think towards you.
Amen.
He said they are thoughts of peace.
Yeah.
And not of evil.
Yeah.
Hey, glory. To give you an expected end.
Yeah.
Ah, glory. And so that's where my confidence lies in God, because I know that he loves me.
Yeah.
And I know that he loves me with an everlasting love.
Thank you,
glory. And so when you understand that the love of God that he has for you, glory, I'm reminded over in Daniel, when the angel told Daniel that you are greatly loved, greatly beloved. You see, I know that I am greatly beloved by God. Glory. You see, you got to receive that. Even the Bible says, be loved.
Yeah.
I heard a preacher say that's a commandment. Right. Be loved.
Yeah.
Allow God to love you. Be loved by God.
Yeah.
Don't reject the love of God.
Yeah.
But he said, but the Bible declares, be loved.
Be loved.
Glory. You see, I know that God loves me.
Mm.
And when you understand that God loves you with the same love that he loved Jesus with. Glory. When you look at John chapter 17 and you look at those verses, and you'll find out that God loves you with the same love that he loved Jesus with. Hey, he don't have a certain love for you and a certain love for Jesus. Yeah, come on, somebody. But he loves you with the same love. My. Help, Lord. Yeah. And then, when you understand that the love that God has for us, and we understand that he loves all of us. Mm-hmm. Glory. He loves all of us. And so when you know that you are the apple of his eye.
Yes.
Glory. And you know that you've been loved by him. You understand that he has the hairs of your head numbered.
Yes.
Glory.
Thank you, Lord.
My God. Yes. When you understand that he cares more about you than he does the sparrows. Mm-hmm. Glory. So when you understand how God feels about you, and that's what one of the things that strengthens my faith. That I know how he feels about me.
Yes.
Glory. Let me read Psalms 40 and 5. I'm going to read to you Psalms chapter 40 and verse 5. It says, many, O Lord, my God, are thy wonderful works, which thou hast done, and thy thoughts, which are to us word. So that part right there says, many are the thoughts that he has towards us.
Yes.
It says, they, talking about the works and the thoughts, they cannot be reckoned up in order unto thee. If I could declare and speak of them, they are more than can be numbered. Talking about the thoughts that God has towards you. Many are the thoughts, hey, glory. See, I can prophesy right now and tell you what God is thinking about. He's thinking about you. Glory.
Right.
You are always on his mind.
Thank you, Jesus.
You need to know and understand that God is in love with you. Glory. You always on his mind. He has many thoughts towards you. Hey, glory.
Thank
he
you,
created the whole world for you. With you in mind.
Yeah.
My God.
You,
he created heaven for you with you in mind.
Thank you.
He allowed Jesus to die upon the cross for you and with you in mind.
Yeah.
When you understand that everything that God does, he does it with you in mind.
Yes, Lord.
My God.
Thank you, Jesus.
There many are the thoughts that God has towards us.
Yes.
When you understand that, it helps you to understand the love of God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Have Lord. Glory.
My God.
Let me share with you Romans 8 and 32. Amen. We're about to get into the meat of this. Hello. Romans 8 and 32. Romans 8 says, and 32 it says, he that spared not his own son. Talking about God.
Come on.
He spared not his own son. He didn't hold his own son back. He didn't spare his own son from death. He didn't spare his own son from shame. He didn't spare his own son from being spit upon.
Yeah.
He didn't spare his own son from receiving a crown of thorns on his head, from receiving nails in his hand and in his foot. Yeah. He didn't spare him. And the reason why he did not spare him was because he was allowing his son to die for you.
Yes.
I told you many other thoughts that he thinks towards you.
My God.
I told you that whatever God does, he does it with you in mind. My God, he allowed Jesus to be crucified with you in mind.
Thank you, Jesus.
My God, he was crucified for you.
Thank you, Lord.
Help, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah. So he didn't spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all. My God. Jesus was delivered to the hands of sinners.
Yes.
Jesus was delivered to the hands of a man for me.
Thank you, Jesus.
My God. He says, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Glory. So how is it that Scripture says that he would now give us Jesus and all things?
Mm-hmm.
Help, Lord.
My God.
See, we understand that you got Jesus and all things. Then you know you can make it.
All right.
Then you know it doesn't matter who or what comes against you.
Yeah.
Because you have Jesus in all things.
Yeah.
And so he didn't spare Jesus, but he gave us Jesus. And because he gave us Jesus, do you not know that there's nothing bigger or better that we can ask God for? So he said, I didn't give you my son. So whatever else you ask me for, you can freely have. Why? Because I have already given you my best.
Thank you, Jesus.
I already gave you Jesus. Jesus is the best I can give you.
Yeah.
So because I didn't give you Jesus, whatever else you ask for, whatever else you ask for, to him is nothing. Because I didn't give you my heart. I didn't give you my love. I didn't give you my only begotten son.
Yeah.
So whatever else you ask for, he said, I'll freely give you that. Glory.
Thank
because
you.
There's nothing that you can ask God for that is greater than he has already given you.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's Jesus.
Jesus.
Help, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
My. But I'm trying to talk to you about faith.
Yeah.
About how that faith and common sense don't miss. Hey, glory. Let's look at Hebrews 11 and 1. We all know what Hebrews 11 and 1 says. Glory. We all know what it says. My. Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 1. We know what it says.
Amen.
No.
It says now.
Hey.
Glory. How many know faith is not later, but faith is now?
Yeah.
Remember that candy called now and later?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah. But faith is not now and later, it's now.
Yeah.
Now faith is.
Yeah.
Glory. And faith is, what is it? It's the substance of things hoped for. My God, I'm not going to concentrate hard on this, but I want to just kind of hit this verse just a little bit. Mm-hmm. But understand that faith is a substance. Understand that faith is tangible.
Yes.
Glory. Faith is tangible.
Yeah.
Now faith is the substance of things hoped for.
Amen.
My God.
Yeah.
And the evidence of things not seen.
Mm-hmm.
You see, your faith can become a physical substance.
Mm.
When Peter stepped out on the water, he stepped out on his faith.
Yeah.
Glory. Your faith is your earnest expectation. What you are earnestly expecting to happen.
Yeah.
That becomes a substance.
Wow.
Jesus. So when Peter stepped out on the water, his earnest expectation, which is his faith, became a substance. And he stepped on his faith.
Yeah.
Glory. When you understand that Peter did not walk on the water, but he walked on his faith.
Mm-hmm.
My God.
Yeah.
When you understand that when Peter first walked out on the water, that he did not, my God, break the water. He did not penetrate the water. No one understands that Peter's feet never got wet.
Mm-hmm.
Because I know we say that he walked on the water, but you need to know and understand that he walked on his faith.
Right.
His faith became a substance, and it was his faith that he was standing and walking on.
Mm.
Help, Lord. And so, notice how the Bible says that it's the evidence of things not seen. My God. Peter didn't see anything in the water.
Yeah.
It's the evidence. How you know it's there? Because you can't see anything. How you know it's there? Because you can't figure out how it's going to work.
Mm.
How you know that God's going to do it? Because I don't know how he's going to do it. Hey, glory, that's what faith is. You don't have no proof. You only believe. My God, help, Lord. My God. So Peter, when he walked on the water, he did not see anything in the water. He didn't see nothing to support him. And that's what faith is. There's no evidence. There's no proof. Glory. But he stepped out anyway. My God. And when he stepped out, And the Bible says he began to sing. Glory. So we know that when we take our eyes off Jesus, that's when we begin to sink into this old world. Glory. And we know that, my God, that was the moment that he got wet. Yeah. Glory of Lord. But notice it says it's the evidence of things not seen. How do I? So if I'm asking God for a specific job that I don't even qualify for. Even this job says that you gotta have a degree. Even this job says you have to have a certain amount of experience. But I may not have what the job requires. I only have a desire for the job. I want that job. Lord. And so this is what I mean by that there's no common sense in faith. Common sense to tell you, you can't get the job because you don't meet the requirements.
Come on.
Yeah. But this is where faith come in at.
Yeah.
Faith becomes a substance. Faith becomes my requirements.
Yeah.
Faith becomes my God, my degree. Faith becomes my experience.
Come
Glory.
On.
Faith becomes whatever I'm lacking. My God, in the name of Jesus.
That's good.
Help, Lord. My. I got Pastor Dave calling me on the phone. Help, Lord. My. Glory. So, my God. Glory. And so, this faith, it doesn't, you cannot mix faith and common sense together. I'm reminded of a man in Africa. And this man wanted to show people how he had faith in God. So he went into a lion's den. And he went into the lion's den and the lions ate him up. Glory. Another man, I believe it was in Africa. He wanted to show people the faith that he had in God. And he got out of a boat and he said he's going to walk on the water and drown. My. Let me tell you something. That is called tempting God. Glory. But let me tell you something. If for some reason or another, you happen to push me in a lion's den, I'm here to tell you that the angels will shut the mouths of the lion and I will not be eaten.
Come on.
Glory. But if I say, hey, watch me, I'm going to go to the lion's den and watch God deliver me, I'm going to be lunch. Come on, that's tempting God.
Yeah.
You see, if I'm in a boat in the middle of Lake Michigan, and somebody pushed me over or some kind of way I end up in that water, glory, I believe that I won't drown. I'm not a good swimmer. I'm closer to a non-swimmer. And so I believe that God will protect me.
Yeah.
I don't know if he's going to send Jonah's well.
All right.
Or I don't know what he's going to do, but I know one thing, I'm not going to drown. Glory. I guess he'll download into my mind swimming. Hey, glory. And all of a sudden, I'm going to know how to swim. I don't know how he's going to do it, my God, because I don't have no proof. I don't have no evidence. I just know he's going to do it.
Yeah.
Hey, glory. Help, Lord. My. But if I say, hey, y'all, watch this. I'm going to get in this water, and I'm going to walk on it. Glory. I'm going down to the bottom.
Yeah.
I'm going to sink down to the bottom. Help, Lord. My.
Amen.
So. Lord. My God, I like talking about faith.
Yeah.
So I want to show you some faith here. In 2 Kings chapter 6. My God, I want to show you some faith here. Jesus. 2 Kings chapter 6. My God. You see, some of us, we have faith, but then we cancel our faith out by adding common sense.
Come on.
It won't work. It won't work. See, we can have faith to walk on water, but if we allow common sense to come in, common sense to say, you cannot walk on water. Water will not hold you up.
Amen.
Glory. But you cannot allow common sense to come in when you're going by faith.
Amen.
Help Lord Jesus. My God. So, 2 Kings chapter 6, let's look at verse 1. It says, and the sons of the prophet, of the prophets, said unto Elisha. Somebody said, I always get those mixed up, somebody might say. Elisha and Elijah. And they wonder which one is first. Well, it's in alphabetical order. Elijah with the J is first. Elisha with the S is second.
Right.
Come on now. Yeah. It says, said unto Elisha, behold, now the place where we dwell with thee is too straight for us. Meaning, there's not enough room. Let us go. Oh, just by the way, Elijah was taken up. Amen. So this is Elisha. Verse 2 says, let us go, we pray thee, unto Jordan, and take thence every man a beam, and let us make us a place there where we may dwell and be. And he answered, go ye. He said, come on, let's go. Remind me of when he said, let us go to our father's house. Verse 3 says, and one said, be content, I pray thee, and go with thy servants. And he answered, I will go. Glory. I don't know about you, but I need the Spirit of the Lord to go with me, the presence of God to go with me.
Yeah.
My God, these men said, we finna go, but we want you, the prophet, to go with us. Because we know that the Spirit of God dwells on you and in you and with you. So, well, my God, so where we going, we want you with us.
Yeah.
Glory.
Yeah.
My God.
Thank you, Lord.
Verse 4 says, so he went with them, and when they came to Jordan, they cut down wood. But as one was filling a beam, meaning he was cutting down a tree, as one was filling a beam, the axe hid, fell into the water, and he cried and said, alas, master, for it was borrowed.
Yeah.
He said, that axe here didn't even belong to me. And now I done lost it in the water. Apparently, the water was deep. Apparently, it fell. He's not sure where the axe here fell at.
Right.
Apparently, he couldn't even see the bottom of the water. Help, Lord. Verse 6. And the man of God said, now, let me keep reading. And the man of God said, where fell it? And he showed him the place. He said, about right over here. Come on. And he cut down a stick and cast it in thither, and the iron did swim.
Yeah.
Jesus. Therefore said he, take it up to thee. And he put out his hand and took it. Glory. So this man, they working to build a house of some type. And so for some reason, they're working by some water because, hey, glory, as he trying to cut down something that the axe head fell in some water. And so when the axe head fell in the water, now they're glad that they brought the prophet along.
Yeah.
Because now by bringing the prophet along, they're bringing along the presence and the Spirit of God with them.
Right.
Help, Lord. And so the axe fell in the water. And so Elisha, cut down a stick and ask him where did it fall. And he put the stick in the water.
Come on.
And when he put the stick in the water, iron that cannot swim.
Come on.
Come on. I'm trying to tell you that faith and common sense don't match. So iron that cannot swim, he put a stick in the water, and the iron swam to the top.
Come on.
Glory.
Yes, Lord.
Help, Lord.
All right.
Not only did the iron swim to the top, but it floated. My God. It floated on top. And the man said, oh, Jesus, there it is. He said, now take it. My God.
Man.
Help, Lord.
Yeah.
You see, if he had to use common sense, he just said, oh, man, I lost the axe here. Now I got to try to replace something that I borrowed from somebody else. It's a loss, and it's a done deal. I can't find it. Glory. Come on. But if you take away common sense, you can't mix common sense with faith. Glory. But faith says, man of God, I need your help.
Jesus.
He called on the man of God because he believed the man of God could help him.
Come on.
He went and called on the man of God. You see, at this time, it was like he was calling on the Spirit of the Lord.
Yeah.
Glory. For the Spirit of the Lord dwelt with the man of God. Mm-hmm. Glory. And so, my God, the iron, come on. Can iron swim?
No.
Glory. He put a stick in the water and the iron floated. My God, swam to the top.
Yeah.
Amen.
They didn't say that it just floated or ran to the top. That iron went to
swimming.
Swimming. Come on, somebody.
Jesus.
It swam to the top and floated. It did the live man float.
Mm.
Glory. Not a dead man, but a live man float. Yeah. Speak life, y'all. Speak life.
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah.
And it reached down and picked it up. Glory. You see how faith works?
Yeah.
Let me tell you something. If you take common sense off, you will not lose anything.
Right.
You will not suffer loss. I'm going to show you how that in God, you won't have to suffer loss.
Yeah.
Glory.
Jesus.
But if you put common sense with it, you're going to suffer loss.
Mm-hmm.
But if you take the common sense out and put the faith in, you shall not suffer loss.
Thank you, Jesus.
Help, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
My God. Do you know you don't have to lose anything?
Yeah.
If you lose anything, my God, you can call upon the name of the Lord.
Yeah.
Yeah. Glory.
You,
let me tell you something. Mm-hmm. They had to call on the prophet.
Yeah.
But now the true prophet is on the inside of you.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ, the prophet.
Yeah.
And now you got a prophet living on the inside of you.
Yeah.
So my God, you can put a stick in the water.
Jesus.
And make that iron swim.
Come on.
Glory. Hey.
Thank you.
My.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm talking about another level of faith.
Yeah.
Help, Lord God. Help, Lord God. Jesus. Over in Daniel 6 and 23, they put Daniel in the lion's den. But the Bible declares that in Daniel 6 and 23 that Daniel made it through the den because he believed God.
Yeah.
The last part of that verse. Help, Lord. The last part of the end of that verse says, because he believed his God. Daniel didn't believe God when he put him in the den, put him down. He didn't start his belief when he put him in the den.
All right.
Daniel believed God before the den.
Uh-huh.
Come on. You see, if you wait until you get in the den, you might be eaten.
All right.
Glory. But the Bible declares that Daniel believed God. This is how he survived the den.
Yeah.
The angels were sent and shut the mouth of the lion. Why? Because Daniel believed in his God.
Yeah.
Glory. When you believe in your God, all things are possible.
Yeah.
When you believe in your God. You know how Noah built the ark? Noah built an ark in the desert.
Mm-hmm.
Big old giant ark.
Yeah.
Glory. Because God told him to.
Mm-hmm.
To build an ark and told him that it was going to rain. Has never rained on the earth before.
Mm-hmm.
But here is Noah building an ark, preparing for something that has never happened in history. Mm-hmm. Never rained before. Mm-hmm. Glory. But God told Noah to build this ark.
Yeah.
And so everybody that saw him building the ark saying, Noah, it doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
It doesn't make sense to build an ark in the middle of a desert. Mm-hmm. Now that you got the ark built, how are you going to get the ark to the sea? My God. Mm. I can see Noah saying, don't worry, the sea going to come to me.
Yeah.
Help Lord.
Jesus.
My God. So if Moses, if Noah had to use common sense, mm-hmm. he'd say, Lord, I can't build no ark because it don't make sense.
Yep.
You see, God will have you to do something that don't make sense.
Mm-hmm.
And when God tell you to do something that don't make sense, you got to know that you heard from God.
Come on.
Others may not agree. Others may not understand. All because he didn't tell them, he told you. You got to do what God told you to do.
Yeah.
My God. And you know the story. My God. He was saved and they were lost.
Mm.
Because they used common sense.
Yeah.
But he used faith.
Jesus.
Help Lord God. Jesus.
Yeah.
My God. Let's look at Hebrews 11 and 5. Hebrews 11 and 5. As a matter of fact, let's go to Mark 5 and 36.
Before.
Yeah. First of all, let's go to Mark chapter 5 and verse 36. And then we'll go to Hebrews 11 and 5. Glory. In Mark 5 and 36, it reads, as soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he said unto the ruler of the synagogue, be not afraid, only believe.
Yeah.
Because here they told Jesus was going to pray for a man's daughter.
Mm-hmm.
And then somebody came and said, hey, she's dead.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus told them, be not afraid, only believe. You see, you got to understand that with faith, you have to just only believe. And you know and understand that all things is possible through God if you only believe.
Yeah.
And when the Bible says only believe, it means it is belief plus nothing else.
Right.
Somebody said, but maybe I should believe and read my Bible.
Mm-hmm.
No, you read your Bible because you believe.
All right.
Somebody said, maybe I should believe and pray. No, you already a prayer warrior. My God, you already pray, and I pray because I believe. Somebody said, well, maybe I got to be more righteous. Yeah, you can't be no more righteous than you already are.
Jesus.
My God, you are the righteousness of Christ.
Yes.
Help, Lord. Now, that's another message in entirely.
Yes.
Glory. But the Bible tells us to only believe. Glory. And see, if you believe in God for something, and you know that it's not by your righteousness. It's not by what you have done. And it's not by what you have not done. It's by his righteousness. And it's by what he has done.
Yeah.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Glory. So your job is to only believe.
Right.
You ain't got nothing else to do but believe.
Yeah.
Glory. Yes. He's not requiring you to do anything else.
Mm-hmm.
My God. Only thing, come on. Whatever you want from God, simply believe.
Yeah.
It's too easy for some of us.
Jesus.
Because we're used to doing a work.
Mm.
We want to be believed plus something else.
Yeah.
My God, but it doesn't work that way.
Yeah.
The Bible says only believe.
Yeah.
Amen. So we're going to hold fast one more time on Hebrews 11 and 5. And let's go to John 6 and 29. John 6. Book of St. John, chapter 6, and verse 29. Help, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
John 6, 29 says, Jesus answered and said unto them, this is the work of God. What is? That ye believe on him whom he hath sent. And so, the work is to believe. That's it. That's why he said only believe. Because the only thing you got to work at is believing. Glory. The work for you to do is simply to believe.
Yeah.
Believe in God. Believe whatever you want from God. Glory.
Yes, Lord.
Just simply believe.
Amen.
Not believing plus this, believing plus that. Just simply believe. Help, Lord.
Yes,
Lord. Because the work is already done.
Yeah.
Jesus did the work on the cross. Glory. Everything is already done. That's why he said it is finished. Because the work is already done.
Yeah.
All you got to do is simply believe.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
My God.
Yeah. Yeah.
So let's look at Hebrews 11 and 5.
Mm-hmm.
Talking about Enoch. And we know that there were two men in the Bible that did not die. Lord. Enoch and Elijah.
Mm-hmm.
Glory. So here in Hebrews 11 and 5, it says, by faith, that's the key.
Yeah.
By faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death.
Yeah.
He was translated by faith. He was translated from the earth to heaven.
Yeah.
It says, and was not found. Because God had translated him. For before his translation, he had this testimony that he pleased God.
All right.
But I want to show you something. Enoch was not translated because he pleased God.
Mm-hmm.
But Enoch did please God. Enoch was translated because what the first part of the verse says. By Enoch's faith.
Mm-hmm.
Enoch had faith that he would not die.
Mm-hmm.
Glory. Look at the faith of this man. Now, I'm trying to tell you, faith and common sense, they don't mix. Come on. And see, that because there is no common sense in faith.
Yeah.
You mean to tell me that this man believed God that he could not die?
Mm-hmm.
Common sense tell you, everybody gonna die. But this man had faith and believed God that he would not die.
Yeah.
Glory. And this man only believed.
Mm.
Glory.
Mm.
He only believed.
Mm.
And he was not translated because he pleased God. That's the life he lived. He pleased God.
Yeah.
Come on. But he was translated because of his faith in God.
Yeah.
Help, Lord. Help, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Show you another example of how faith and common sense don't mix. Let's go to Acts 28 in the book of Acts, chapter 28. Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let's look at verses 3 through 6. Romans 8.
Acts. 28 or 8?
I'm sorry. The book of Acts, chapter 28.
Oh.
Come on. See, y'all know I just made a mistake.
That's all right.
But y'all want to let y'all come confused. I know I'm talking about Acts. Romans, okay. So Acts 28, verse 3, it says, and when Paul had It says, when Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and laid them on the fire, there came a viper out of the heat and fastened on his hand.
Mm-hmm.
And when the barbarians saw the venomous beast hang on his hand, they said among themselves, no doubt this man is a murderer, whom though he has escaped the sea because he just came out of a shipwreck, yet vengeance suffered not to live, meaning suffered him not to live. Verse 5, and he shook off the beast into the fire and felt no harm. My God. Howbeit, they looked when he should have swollen or fallen down dead suddenly. But after they had looked a great while and saw no harm come to him, they changed their minds and said that he was a god. They went from calling Paul a murderer to calling him a god. That goes to show that how flaky people are. Glory. People will call you one thing, and then when they see something else, then they'll call you something else.
Come on.
People are flaky. But here we see that Paul was making a fire, and a poisonous snake slashed onto his hand, bitten by a poisonous snake. And they knew that Paul was going to die. But Paul shook it off.
Yeah.
Shook off the snake into the fire.
Shake it off.
Glory. Common sense says, I just got bit by a poisonous snake. I don't have no antidote. Come on.
Come on.
Ain't no doctor around. Ain't no hospital around. This is a viper, a poisonous snake. I'm finna die. Our Father, which art in heaven. It's time to pray. Come on. But Paul, come on somebody.
Come on.
Didn't use common sense.
Jesus.
Paul said, not today, snake. Not today, death. Paul said, no, I'm on a mission for God.
Thank you.
Glory.
Thank you, Lord.
Glory. And then when you understand how the Bible tells us that Elijah, that I think was Elijah or Elisha, I believe it was Elijah. It says that Elijah was a man of like faith. Mm-hmm. It said that he caused it not to rain on the earth for the space of 3 years and 6 months. Mm. But he said he was a man of like faith. Mm,
yeah.
And it's talking about the fact that he was nobody special. He was nobody special. And so when you understand that Paul is nobody special,
yeah,
you understand that God does not respect, has no respect of person.
Come on.
God does not love Paul more than he loves you.
Mm.
So when you understand that the Bible was written for our understanding,
yeah,
it was written for us to see what God can do.
Yeah.
Glory. It was written for us to learn from.
Yeah.
Let me tell you something. If you get bit by a poisonous snake, if you use common sense, you're going to die.
Yeah.
But if you call upon the name of the Lord and you shake it off and you say, Lord, you are of no respect to person.
Yeah.
You did it for Paul, man. Do it for me.
All right.
Glory.
Yeah.
I'm here to tell you that you can shake some things off.
Yes, Lord.
Glory. You don't have to receive every time something happened to you. You do not have to receive what has happened. But you can allow faith to kick in,
yeah,
and you can shake that thing off. Glory.
All right.
You can shake that thing off.
Yes, Lord.
My God, in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Ah. My. I'm going to share one more. No. My. Lord. And so, Lord, I'm going to read this part, the passage of scripture here. I'm going to read to you Ephesians chapter 6, 13 and 14. Ephesians 6, 13 and 14, it says, wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God,
yeah,
that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, stand therefore, having your loins girded about, my God, with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness. Amen. I'm going to stop there because I just wanted to show you where the Bible says that after have done all to stand, stand.
Yeah.
Glory. When you put your faith in God, you put your trust in God. Glory. Stand.
Stand.
Yes. And after you have done all you can do to stand, stand.
Yeah.
Glory. Continue to stand on the word. Continue to stand in God. Continue to believe. Don't allow common sense to come in and take your faith from you.
Yeah.
Glory. I know some won't agree with what I'm saying, because some are so earthly minded, they'll say, no, it doesn't make sense. So they're going to go with what makes sense. But when it comes to faith, faith does not make sense.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
Faith will tell you to build an ark in the desert. Glory.
All right.
Faith tell you that you just got bit by a poisonous snake. Shake it off.
Yeah.
Glory.
Thank you, Jesus.
My God, faith tell you that that whatever you lost can swim up to you.
Jesus.
Glory.
Jesus.
My God. So I'm trying to share with you tonight another level of faith.
All right.
My God. And so Enoch believed that he could not die. By faith, he was translated.
Yeah.
Lord.
Thank you.
And see, I believe that I can't get sick. Mm-hmm. Common sense says any man can get sick. Glory. But my faith says I'm already healed.
All right.
And if I'm already healed, then how can I get sick?
Jesus.
Help, Lord. My God. So by faith.
By faith.
Glory. That's why COVID-19 has no effect on me.
Yeah.
I was telling somebody just the other day, I was telling my wife that, my God, that people are wearing a mask. But I already have on a mask.
Jesus.
You can't see my mask.
Yeah. Come on.
Glory. But I'm already wearing a mask.
Come on. Yeah.
My God, the Holy Spirit has his hand over my nose and over my mouth. Glory. You see, the air that I breathe is filtered by the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
My God, you can stand next to me, and I'm here to tell you that the air that I breathe is filtered.
My.
I don't need a mask over my mouth for my air to be filtered. Glory. You might need a mask over your mouth, but I don't need one over my mouth because, my God, I got the Holy Ghost hand over my mouth.
Yeah.
Glory. The air that I breathe is already filtered.
Yeah,
glory. Ah, help, Lord. I'm talking to you about another level of faith. My God. See, the mask that you have, something can creep inside of.
Yeah.
The mask that you have, my God, may have to be washed.
Jesus.
The mask that you have may have to be changed and put on another one and all of these things. But the mask that I wear is an everlasting mask. The mask that I wear, my God, is keeping me.
Yeah.
Hey, glory. And nothing going in that should not go in.
Man.
My.
Yeah.
Glory. I'm talking to you about another level of faith.
Yeah.
Jesus. Even the Bible tells us that hope that is seen is not hope.
Yeah.
Glory. But that which you don't see, my God, that's what you hope for. But that which you see, he said, why hope for it?
Yeah.
Glory. But my God, but hope, my God, that you can't see, now that's hope.
Yeah.
Meaning, if you don't see how God is going to do it, that's how you know he's going to do it.
Yeah.
Glory. You're asking God for something, you're believing God for something, and you see how, and you got a plan, and you know how God's going to do it, it ain't going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Huh? Because if you got a plan, then go do it yourself.
Yeah.
Help, Lord. But my God, when you're asking and believing God for something, and you just can't figure out how it's going to happen,
yeah.
Now God can move.
Yeah.
Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen.
Yeah.
How I know he's going to do it? Because I have no proof.
Right.
How I know he's going to do it? Because I don't see how it can be done.
Yeah.
Now that's faith.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Blessed be the name of the Lord God Almighty.
Amen.
My God.